This morning, I would like to do something a little different. We're in a
that season every time this month comes around, we start having graduation parties and honoring those that have accomplished school, and some of them are like, yes, I'm so glad to be done. Did any of you miss school? Anyone? Just a few? So we have a couple of graduates here. We have a total of 6 graduates in our youth program, but we also have one that I know of that just graduated from college. And so I think an awesome way to start a morning together in worship is to honor. Because honor, I believe, is also an act of worship. And when we can see that someone has made a huge accomplishment, I know we can't do that all the time. I'm sure I could ask all of you all the accomplishments that you've had in life, and I wish we could always bring everyone up. But I know this is a big milestone. Honestly, it's almost like a rite of passage for most, you know, where at this age, not only graduating from high school, they're hitting an age where they're also moving into independence and adulthood. And so it's just a huge moment for our graduates. And some of them are here today. Some attend other churches on a Sunday morning and will join us tonight, and we'll be able to honor them then. But this is what I would love to do if you will join me. Nothing crazy. If you are a student that has graduated high school or about to graduate high school in the next week, or if you're a college graduate, would you come to the front here? Because we're going to take a moment to pray over you. I actually have a gift for you as well. Who loves gifts? Huh? And you get a gift, and you get a gift. And a little Oprah joke there. Okay. All right. If you'll turn to them, if any family or friends will come up and surround them, I would love for us to pray over them. So if you are a family member, if you are a close friend, love for you to join them. And now, if you will you pray with me? Will you come into agreement? And we're just going to pray over them as this new season of life that they're entering into. At the same time, we just want to honor them for the hard work they put in. 4.0s, yes? Sure? So they were very excellent students, and they're going to continue that, and so we're excited for that. So let's will you close your eyes and pray with me, and let's just pray a blessing over them. Father God, we just thank you right now. God, we thank you for in these last 18 or so years that you have blessed them, that you have worked through them. God, I've gotten to know them in the past 8 to 9 months, and being able to see them grow even in this short amount of time, Father, thank you that you have used them in such a mighty and powerful way. We know that this is a huge milestone in one's life, where we go from being dependent to moving on to independence. And so, Father, we pray for blessing and favor over them as wherever they go from here. If it's going off to a college, starting their career, whatever it is, God, I pray that you will continue to bless it as they surrender their life to you. Father, I know that we have many more graduates that can't be here this morning, but we want to also pray for them, that you will continue to move in their life. And Father, as a church body, just like how we do baby dedications and baptisms, where it's just moments of just witnessing with one another and saying, hey, we support you. Right, that is the body that we come together and surround, that even though they may go to a different state, a different city, Father, they are part of this family. And so, Father, I pray that you will continue to move among them, and that this church body will support them any way they can. And so, Father, we thank you. We thank you for what you have done in their life and what you will continue to do. And so we just pray for that blessing right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys so much, and congratulations. One more thing before I read some scripture and we move into worship. Some of you know Lee Kramer, and yesterday I was told that he was in a major car accident. You may know this, maybe this is the first time that you're hearing this. From what I've heard and what I've seen, they seem to have gotten some things a little bit more stable, but obviously it's a scary situation. And as you know, Lee has been a member here for a very long time, and he's been a huge supporter. And he served with us in youth back in Christmas, and an amazing, amazing guy. And so I want to pray for him. Can we do that? Can we pray for him? I know there's so many other prayers that we could be praying for and other people we know. I just know this was an immediate need, and yesterday seemed to be very scary, and I'm sure for his wife Ann to even experience that, to probably get a phone call that your husband was in a serious car accident and was airlifted to the hospital. So if you will, again, will you pray with me right now? Let's just pray for him. Father God, I just pray for Lee. God, I pray right now that your Holy Spirit, where he is laying in the ICU with the doctors, God, that he feels your presence. Father, I pray that everything that they've already done, the surgeries and trying to either stop things or put things back into place, Father, I pray for that healing. God, I pray you be with Anne and you give her a peace in these moments of trials. God, I pray for Lee that you give him a peace. I pray you'll give them a joy, as your word says, that we can find joy in tribulation. God, that in that we can find maturity and completeness. So, Father, I just pray right now for his healing. I pray for a blessing over them. And God, as a church body, as we know him and how he has prayed for us before, God, we intercede right now as a body for him. In a moment where maybe he can't fully open his mouth right now, he's probably asleep, resting. God, we will open our mouths for him and say, God, we pray that you will bring that healing that you say that you can bring. And so, Father, be with the doctors. Guide them as they try to figure everything out and stabilize what needs to be stabilized. And so, Father, we believe that you are a God that heals, you're a God that moves, and even in these situations that are unknown and kind of crazy, you are a God of peace and chaos. You are a God of order. And so we pray for that right now. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, if you'll stand with me, I want to read Psalms 1. We're going to stand in reverence for the Word of God. Allow the Word of God to be spoken over you. May you receive this as we go into a time of worship. Psalm 1, verse 1 says this: Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. And all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Father God, we thank you for your word. God, I thank you that you delight in those that are righteous. God, that you will correct that those that are wicked. Father, I pray that you will show us how to be a healthy church. Your body, the one that you call your bride, that you love so much that you died on the cross. Father, in this time of worship, as we may sing with our mouth, as we stand in reverence of who you are, God, may we remember all that you've done in our life. With all the praise, all the worthiness, God, you are worthy of it all. And so, Father, we submit right now. We thank you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Psalms 148 says, Praise the name of the Lord forever, for his name alone shall be exalted. So we're going to do that this morning with What a Beautiful Name. He sing it out.
You were the word. One with God, the Lord Most High. You're hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you upright. What a beautiful name it is.
Sing it out.
What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Didn't want. Here we go.
You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus,
yeah.
To worship, here I am.
to see my sin upon that cross, and I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross, and I'll never know how much it cost to see.
The song we're getting ready to do is another one that we did over Easter time. It has always been one of my favorites, at least ever since it came out a few years ago. King of Kings says, praise God. Just praise the Lord. It's just a song of praise. It's one of my favorites, like I said, so it's familiar to us. I know it's familiar to you guys. So feel free to sing along if you know it.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven.
thank you so much that you're a God that we can freely praise. Lord, your name is higher than anything. Lord, you are higher, and your thoughts are higher than we could ever ask or think, Lord. You're so much greater than anything we could ever imagine. Just thank you so much, Lord, for everything you are. You guys may be seated.
Well, sweet, sweet. Thank you, Brother George, and thank you, choir, and thank you for the sweetness of the Spirit that you just enjoy the worship of God. I hold in my hand a commemorative birth certificate, all right? This is not my real live birth certificate that could be used for documentation. This is just a commemorative copy of the birth certificate of one David Drake, and it has all the information. It has all that, you know, appropriate information that is necessary to let you know that I am alive. It has in there supervising physician that brought me into this world. It has the names of my mother and my father. It has the day that I was born, which was Thursday, July the 9th. It also tells you that I was born at 6:50 a.m. Why don't babies come in the middle of the afternoon? I'll never know, but it tells you that I was a male child, amazingly, in this day and time. We won't go there. I was 8 pounds and 8 ounces, and I was 21 inches in length. And it has my little teeny tiny footy prints on there, and all God's people said, oh, yeah, right. The one amazing thing about this birth certificate, it tells you everything about my beginning. It tells you nothing about my journey. Such is your life as well. It tells you, if you were to show us and reveal your physical birth certificate, it would tell us everything about you in your beginning. But it tells us nothing about the journey that you have been on all these years of your life. Now, associate that now with your spiritual birth. If you have experienced a born-again experience, you have been saved, you have become a part of God's family, and you have been born into His family, you might be able to go back to a place, a date, a time, a situation, an individual, or whatever the circumstances may be. And that tells us a lot about your beginning. But it may say nothing about your journey. And we have been on a journey in these last few weeks looking at blueprints of a healthy church. We've looked at all kinds of subjects, the godly church we began with, and then we segued into the gospel church. Last week we studied around being the grounded church. And so I want to invite you to take your Bible, and we're going to look at two passages of Scripture this morning. If you have your Bible with you, I trust you do, there will be two passages, one in the Old Testament, one in the New Testament, all right? So let's go to the Old Testament first, as Brother George so beautifully read for us just moments ago, Psalm 1. If you would find the first psalm, it's right there in the text of your Old Testament Scripture. If you'll look at Psalm 1 for just a moment, I believe if you look very carefully, and if you listened to George's reading of that just moments ago, if you picked up, you'll find out that there are some growth principles there. because that's what we're going to be looking at today. As we've looked at these other previous studies, as we are looking at the healthy church, and I forgot to tell everybody, yes, I just saw you moving. Boys and girls, you can go to children's worship. If you're still with us, thank you, George. I'll get it eventually. But if you're a child in here and you'd like to, well, I think I just saw one or two leave. There we go. Okay, well, let's see. Where was I? Oh, yes. We're looking at the growing church. The growing church. And there are three very, very specific, three growth principles found in Psalm 1, verses 1, 2, and 3. I want you to look at those very carefully. It's a beautiful psalm. And yet it speaks to us, I believe, very, very, very vividly about our growth. As a follower, as a believer, as an individual, as well as our growth as a healthy church. Now notice with me just for a moment, verse 1 of Psalm 1. Again, the Bible says, "How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers." Let me give you the first principle of growth. I believe drawn right out of that verse of Scripture. Decide. This is very important. Decide today. Decide right now to progress, not regress. You as an individual, I as an individual, we as followers of Christ, we as a church, if we're really going to understand the health that we can experience, then there's got to be some principles of growth that we must apply in our lives individually and we as a body. The first is to make a decision. I want to decide today, right now in this place, I am going to decide to progress and not regress, not go backwards. I want to go forward. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. No turning back, we sing oftentimes. Now, I want you to notice something very, very important, and you and I need to remember about that first statement there, about making the decision that right now I am going to progress, not regress. Just remember this. If you decide to walk in the wrong direction, is that not what the psalmist says? How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked? If you decide to walk in the wrong direction, if you decide to stand with the sinful crowd, notice that again, nor stand in the path of sinners. If you decide to sit with those who scorn righteousness, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. If you make that decision that you decide to walk in the wrong direction, stand with the sinful crowd, sit with those who scornfully point their finger at righteousness, then just remember this. You will not, and I'm going to stand before you this morning, and I'm going to boldly assert, you will not grow spiritually. If you find yourself standing or going in the wrong direction, standing with a sinful crowd, sitting with those who scorn righteousness, you will not grow spiritually. And by the way, ultimately, you will probably have made a spiritually fatal decision. You know, the sad thing about it is that's where a lot of church people are today. Sadly, and I don't like to stand up here like a prophet of doom, but I really believe that there's a lot of church family. There's a lot of people within the confines of our churches. Take off the shingle. It doesn't matter what denomination, what place, where you plant yourself. There's a lot of people in our churches, even today, that are doing just that. They are finding themselves associated in just the areas that they should not, walking in the wrong direction, standing with sinners, walking and putting their lives around those who scorn righteousness. And as a result, you are finding yourself in a very fatal, spiritually fatal position. And so that's principle number one. Decide today that that's not going to be you, okay? Just make that decision in the balcony, here on the main floor. Make the decision today that I will not find myself as one of those in verse 1 of Psalm 1. But look at verse 2. There's a second growth principle. First, decide to progress, not regress. Secondly, devote yourself to the source of growth. Devote yourself to the source of growth. Notice again in verse 2 what the Bible says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Now there's something very important there that you and I need to devote ourselves to, and that is that the source of growth is the law of the Lord. That's the source of growth, is the law of the Lord. Is that not what he says again? But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. So that's the source of your strength. That's the source of your growth. Now think about this just for a moment. What is the source of your physical growth? You ever thought about that? What is the source of your physical growth? Now, if I were to open it up and we were to have a question and answer and we were to, you know, poll you, some of you would raise your hand and you would say, it's food. Food is the source of my growth. And you can see, I mean, food is the source of, well, and you'd be right. Someone would probably raise their hand and say, exercise, and you would be right. Someone say, breathing clean air and all of those things that we associate with physical growth are very appropriate and needed in our lives. Now, here's a second question. What if you abstain from that? What if you just abstain from food? What kind of condition would you be in? What if you abstain from any form of exercise, whether it's just a very casual recreational walking or whether you're on the treadmill or you're pumping iron or whatever? What if you abstain from that? What if you abstain from good social relationships and interaction with other people as a source of your physical growth? What if you abstain from all of that? What kind of condition would you be in? What? You'd be a pitiful sight, wouldn't you? You would. You and I would both, and all of us would be a pitiful, pitiful sight if we abstained from all of those elements that would help and assist us in our physical growth. Why in the world, ladies and gentlemen, family of God, why in the world then do we abstain from this? The law of the Lord. Why? That's the source of your growth. That's the source of your spiritual growth. Well, preacher, now, you just don't understand. I just don't understand the Bible. You do not know how many times in 100 years of ministry that I've had, you have no idea how many times people have said that to me. I'll say, hey, Chuck, you reading your Bible? Well, you know, I just don't understand that Bible. Hey, Rufus, are you reading your Bible every day? No, I don't. I just don't understand the Bible. I just let the preacher tell me what it says. You know what you're doing? You're stunting your spiritual growth. The principle of growth is not being applied to your life. The Bible, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the Bible. You remember that little jingle? We used to sing that in Vacation Bible School, but for some reason, we sort of never got it applied into our system. We never got it really super applied into our heart. And so there is a principle of growth. Not only make the decision that you're going to progress and not regress, but to devote yourself to the source of growth. And that source is in the law of the Lord. But you know what? It's also, watch this. And this is, I'm not trying to do a wordplay with you. You ready for this? It's also in the Lord of the law. Did you hear the first part of this? You see, devoting yourself to the source of your growth means that you're going to devote yourself, you're going to give yourself to the law of the Lord, but you're also going to give yourself to the Lord of the law. That's what we should be delighting in. Every time you read that, you ought to see Jesus in there. Every time you read that, you ought to see God's plan in there. Every time we read it, not just to get warm and fuzzy feelings. No, we ought to see God's plan and God's direction for our lives, for our spiritual growth. There's one final thing. Oh, by the way, would you just, for just a moment, would you take your Bible, put your finger there in Psalm 1, turn to Psalm 19. It's just a couple of pages up from your Bible, Psalm 19. Would you look beginning Would you look beginning at verse 7? Listen to what the Bible says. And by the way, you can do it. I'm going to give you a little homework, okay? That's good for us. We need a little homework along the way. School's out almost, and we need a little homework just to kind of take off the edge. Look at what the Bible says in Psalm 19, verse 7. The law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul. Isn't that wonderful to know that the law will restore your soul? The testimony of the Lord is pure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true, and they are righteous altogether. Now watch this. They, meaning the scripture, they, meaning the law of the Lord, they, meaning the word of God, they are more desirable than gold, yes, than much fine gold, sweeter than the honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them, the word of God, the law of the Lord, the scriptures, moreover, by them, your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Wow. Do you hear that? That's the reason that this principle of growth is all centered around the Word of God. Now, here's your homework, okay? You ready for this? Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're really ready for some homework. Thank you very much. Psalm 119. Okay? Not 19, but Psalm 119. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to read that today. Sometime in your leisure. Read it today and make a note of every statement in the Bible that has something like the testimony, the law, the precepts, the word, something. It'll be there, I promise you. I'm not going to tell you how many times, but then after you've read through Psalm 119, which, by the way, is the longest chapter in your English Bible, but if you'll read through that and circle or make a note of every time you read something that sounds like the Bible, something that sounds like the scripture, every time you do, and then count them up, and you'll see how important the Word of God is to the Lord Himself and how important it ought to be to us. So therefore, decide to progress, not regress. Devote yourself to the source of growth. And then thirdly, back in Psalm 1, verse 3, notice, display the evidence of your growth. Display the evidence of your growth or your growing. You see, you made the decision that you're going to grow. You're going to progress and not regress. You're going to devote yourself to the very source of growth, which is the law of the Lord and the Lord of the law. And so therefore, what's going to happen? There's going to be something coming from you, and it's a display. Notice he says, he will be like a tree firmly planted by the streams of water. You're going to be like a tree firmly established. You'll be like yielding your fruit in its season, faithful and commitment. You'll be a fruitful follower of God. And its leaf does not wither. God's going to protect those areas of your life that He knows specifically how to protect and give you divine guidance through any storm, through any difficulty. And then you will be a growing believer. And whatever He does, He prospers. He prospers. She prospers. Now, that's just the principles. They're just three little principles. Decide that you're going to progress and not regress. Devote yourself to the source of your growth. And then finally, display it. Show it off. Let others see Jesus in you. Let others see Jesus in you. Keep telling the story. Be faithful. Be true. Let others see Jesus in you. And with that, let me ask you to turn to the second passage of Scripture in the New Testament, John chapter 15. John chapter 15. Would you find your Bible open to John chapter 15? Notice with me for just a moment, in these verses that are before us, in the very teaching ministry of the Lord Jesus, something extremely important. I love John 15. I mean, you want to read something practical. You want to read something that will really help you in your spiritual growth. Well, here you are. You have arrived at John chapter 15. Jesus is teaching His disciples, and now we have that wonderful word from Him that teaches us. And so therefore, what is this growing church all about? What's this healthy church? And what should this healthy church be? It should be a growing church. So therefore, look, if you will, at John chapter 15 and verse 1. Notice that you and I need to acknowledge again. We need to acknowledge the source of our growth. Now, this may surprise some of you, but listen to what Jesus says in verse 1. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Drop down to verse 4 and 5. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Now, did you hear that? Now, that's the Lord Jesus, the one who saved your soul, who has redeemed you for all eternity. That's what he's telling for you and for me about acknowledging the source of our growth. Now, isn't it interesting that he didn't say anything about Sunday school there? I'm not against Sunday school. I love it. But he didn't say anything about Sunday school there, did he? He wasn't pointing to a class or a classroom. Isn't it interesting? It almost hurts your heart when he didn't say anything about a congregation. He didn't say anything about a congregation, did he? He never said anything about being a Southern Baptist or being a part of a denomination of any sort. He didn't say anything about a small group, a Bible study, a women's retreat, a men's outing. He didn't say anything about the source of your growth. Now, I get into all those things. I really do. I've had lots of people tell me, oh, Pastor, have you never gone on the Emmaus Walk? No, I haven't. Oh, I tell you what. You've got to go on the Emmaus Walk. It is absolutely. And it's almost like that individual, and I'll just say that individual, was putting all of their effort and energy that the source of your growth will be the Emmaus Walk. You're not a part of a small group. Oh, I can't believe this. How are you growing as a Christian? How are you growing as a believer? You got to get into a small group. You got to get. I'm all for that. But Jesus didn't say that, did he? Did you notice the very first statement that he made in John chapter 15? Look at it again in verse 1. I am the vine. You know what that tells me? That tells me that if he's described us as branches, he's the source of our growth. You see, everything should point back to Jesus. Everything. And I'm not against groups. Please don't leave here thinking, well, he is just anti-groups, or he is anti-Sunday school, or he is... No, I'm not. It's just that that's not the source of my spiritual growth. My spiritual growth should be with me and him. I should be alone with him. And this precious word that he has for me should be a major part of his communication into my heart, into my life, that will then give me the spiritual growth that I so desperately need. Listen to this. He is our source. Listen. He is our source. Are you listening? Would you say amen? He is our source because he is the source. He is our source because he is the source. And we can run and find and think that, oh, just one more meeting and just one more gathering and one more opportunity and one more this, one more that. Oh, that'll do it for me. When all along the Lord Jesus says, I'm your source. I'm the answer to everything that you possibly need. So first, we need to acknowledge, again, the source of our growth, and that is Jesus Christ. Would you say his name with me? Jesus Christ. Isn't that sweet to be able to say the greatest name that's ever been uttered, Jesus Christ? Secondly, notice also in John chapter 15 that you and I need to affirm the process. We need to affirm the process of our growth. If you and I are going to be the healthy church that God so desires and he has so designed for this fellowship and your fellowship to be, you know what we need to do? Well, first, we need to acknowledge who the source is, and secondly, we need to affirm. We need to affirm the process. Now, what is that process? Well, he gives us the first part of that action plan in verse 2. Notice in verse 2, there is the process of pruning. He says in verse 2, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so it may bear more fruit. There's the process of pruning. You and I need to affirm that. And that means that sometimes God knows exactly how to burnish off the rough edges of our life with some heavenly sandpaper. He knows how to cut back some areas of our life, and he brings those areas to our attention so that it will then get out of our life in order to produce more fruit for him. Pruning is such an important part of our life. We don't like it. We don't say, oh, God, hit me again. No, we don't do that. But that pruning process is his process to spiritually cultivate that which he is trying to create within us, and that is his image in our lives to a world that needs to see him. So first there's pruning. But notice, if you will, in verse 3, there's also cleansing. You and I need to affirm this process not only from pruning but also from cleansing. You see, the Bible says you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. You know what the cleansing process is? The Bible. Here we go. We're right back to it again, aren't we? It's the Bible. Can I ask some of you, you don't have to do it for me. You're going to do it for you. But do it for God's glory. Would you blow the dust off of your Bible and start reading it again? Let it cleanse your heart. Let it cleanse your life. I trust that you're not running from it, but that you'll run to it. Because there's a truth there that God wants to teach you and tell you. There's an abundance of life that he wants to provide for you if you will allow him. He is talking. He is speaking at all times. And he does it primarily through his word. So this is the cleansing process. You are clean through the word. But there's a third process. Look again, if you will, at verse 4 and 5. It's abiding. Affirm that being a part of the process. Abiding. And the very voice of this is active, and so therefore it means you do it. Listen to what he says in verse 4. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. In other words, I can't do this for you. Y'all got that? Your grandmother, who is now in heaven, as influential as she might have been, or your grandfather, as impacting to your life as he might have been, they can't do it for you. We don't ride on their coattails. There are no grandchildren in heaven. No, it's your responsibility. It's my responsibility. I need to take up my cross. I need to listen to what God is saying to me about his word and his direction for my life. Some of you are right now at the throw of a decision. I don't know what that decision may be, but you're right in the midst of a decision that is extremely important in your life. You know what it is. You fill in the blank. What direction are you getting? Is God speaking to you, or are you allowing him to speak to you? Well, let me tell you something. Go to his word. Go to his word. A long time ago, sitting in the choir loft of a Baptist church in this state, struggling with the will of God for my life. I was in professional photography, thought that was going to be my career. But boy, God was just really this. I mean, for me, it was truly a surrender of my life to the ministry. But I couldn't come to that. I mean, I was really struggling. And I had my Bible, getting ready to listen to the man of God preach the word of God in the choir loft. And there was a woman who was in the alto section sitting next to me. She had a little card. And she said, here, read this when you get an opportunity. And she slipped it into that Bible. I said, okay, thank you. The pastor preached his message. The invitation was given. And boy, you talk about struggling. Whew, man, I knew God wanted me to do something, but I just couldn't put it together. And so you know what I did? Did what anybody would probably want to do. I went to the Word of God. God, I'm desperate. I need to know from you what you want for me, what you have planned for my life. And so right before we stood to begin to sing the invitation, I opened my Bible, and guess where it fell? Where that woman had put that card. I didn't know that. We didn't have any specific place. But it fell into Mark chapter 4, which says, with God, nothing is impossible. Bang! You talk about an answer. Man, that thrilled my soul. We stood and I couldn't get down to the... And so when I got to the altar area and took the preacher by the hand, I said, God has called me to preach. Let me tell you something. God has an answer for you as well. He has an answer for all of us. And don't sit there and look back at me like, well, David, that's fine for you, and that's good for your story, but you don't know mine. No. All you need to do is just read what God has planned for you, what God has planned for this church. And so there is this process that he's got us going through, pruning, cleansing, abiding. And then look at verse 10 of John chapter 15, obedience. Because the Bible says in verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. And just as I have kept my Father's commandments, I abide in his love. There is that we need to affirm the activity, the action plan of obedience in our lives. It makes us a healthy church, makes us a healthy believer. Obedience. You choose to obey in order to continue to grow. You see, that's what's going to happen to some of you, and well, I should say really that's going to happen to all of us. Every single one of us today is going to make a choice. Did you know that? Every single one of you are going to make a choice. You're going to choose to do something. Because if you say, no, I'm not going to choose to do something, you've made your choice. And so therefore, obedience affirms this wonderful growth that he has in our life. And then, finally, verse 27 of John chapter 15, witness. That's right. You see, affirming this process of growth in your life and in mine produces all of these wonderful things as we abide in him and as we obey him and as we find ourselves being pruned and cleansed through his word. You know what it does? It gives us an opportunity to be a shining and obedient witness. Listen to what verse 20 says, and you will testify also because you have been with me from the beginning. You will be a testimony. And by the way, in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, Paul was instructing Timothy. He said, Timothy, don't let anybody look down on your youthfulness. Now, here's an 80-year-old preacher, 80-year-old apostle, talking to a 40-year-old apprentice. Don't let anybody give you shame. Don't let anyone put you to shame as to your youthfulness. You be an example of the believer. First Baptist Church of McKaysville, Copper Hill, you be the example of what a believer looks like and talks like and acts like. See, that creates health in your life individually. It creates health in this body life. It creates health in this community. People begin to see you and hear you act different and talk different and respond differently. And that's what they need. That's what you need. That's what I need. That's what God wants from all of us. It's a testimony. It's a testimony. And so therefore, we acknowledge the source. We affirm the process, and the final thing is we announce the results. What are the results of this healthy, growing Christian, follower of Christ, body? What's the result of that? Well, verse 8, you get the first part of the Trinity involved. You get God the Father. You see, in verse 8, we glorify God through our growth. Listen to what Jesus says in verse 8 of John chapter 15. My Father is glorified by this. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit, so prove to be my disciples. You see, you and I are glorifying through our lives because we are a growing believer. We are a healthy, growing church. It has a tendency to glorify God. He says, you will glorify the Father in heaven because of your fruitfulness, because of your growth. So you and I glorify the Father. The second thing is found there in verse 5. It incorporates the Son. The Father, now the Son. We reveal the Son of God through our growth. Notice, the Bible tells us in verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. Did you hear that? We reveal the Lord Jesus. I heard the story of a little boy that was in Sunday school. You may have heard this as well. I may have even shared this with you. Little boy in Sunday school, and it was time to have kind of art and crafts in Sunday school that day. And so all the boys and girls had their crayons, and all the boys and girls had their paper, and they were all drawing something. And the teacher was very sweetly walking by and seeing a church and seeing a sunset and seeing a rainbow and all this kind of stuff. And here's a little boy, and he was drawing a picture. She said, Jason, what is that? He said, it's a picture of God. She said, well, sweetheart, no one knows what God looks like. And Jason said, they will when I finish. I'm going to show you Jesus. You ready? I am. I'm going to show you a picture of Jesus. Now, it's not going to be up on the screen, and I'm not going to certainly point to myself or any of us. I'm going to take the Word of God, and I'm going to show you a portrait. You ready? Seriously. You ready to see Jesus in the Bible? I'm going to show you a portrait of Him. If you'll take your Bible, put your finger there in John chapter 15. We'll come back to that one more time. Galatians chapter 5. That's right. Go ahead. You want to see what Jesus looks like? You want to see His character, His nature? You want to see the very essence of who He is and His passion and His person? In Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23, you have a picture, a portrait of Jesus. You ready? Here it comes. Now, the fruit of the Spirit is this, and here it comes. Nine strokes on the canvas of eternity shows you Jesus. Ready? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Let's just go over those again one more time. We want to make sure that we see this clearly of who Jesus really is, His person and His passion. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Doesn't that look like Jesus to you? If you were to just sort of take each one of those strokes, those nine wonderful strokes on the canvas of eternity and looking at, doesn't that look like Jesus to you? Doesn't that sound like Jesus to you? Isn't that a revelation of who He is? Isn't that a revelation of His passion for the world? Isn't that Jesus in those nine statements? I think it is. And guess what? That's what you and I should look like. But you grow in that. It doesn't come just automatically. It's there because it's the fruit of the Spirit. But you grow into loving and joy, and in the essence of joy and peace and patience and loving kindness. And you grow into all of those beautiful portraits of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so finally, we submit to the Spirit of God for our growth. In John chapter 15 and verse 26, there's a submission to the third part of this wonderful Trinity, and that's the Helper. When the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, that is the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, He will testify of me. There's the Spirit of God that's involved in your and my and our spiritual growth. The health of a church finds itself there in the very essence of who God is, as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But there's something else that you and I need to understand, and that is, if we have the desire to grow, we must equally have the desire to die. Now, hold on. Let me close down with this. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, the Bible says from the pen of the Apostle Paul under God's inspiration, "For I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life that I am now living by faith, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me." Did you hear that? In order for you and I to really grow, we must first learn how to die. Jesus said that in John chapter 12 when He said, "You take a seed and you plant it in the ground, and unless it dies, it cannot produce growth." Spiritually speaking, we have to die to ourselves. As a matter of fact, I wrote down just a thought. You ready for this? A healthy church is a dying church. Now hang on to that. Let that just process for a moment from what we just shared in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, that a healthy church is a dying church. In other words, a healthy church is a church that realizes that it's not about me. It's not about us. It's all about Christ. Because why? I have been crucified with Christ. You have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, we live, but it's not us. It is Christ in us that brings about not only a growing church, but a healthy church. I don't know if any of you have ever read anything from Brennan Manning, The Ragamuffin Gospel. If you haven't, that's quite a read. There was a group a number of years ago named DC Talk. They were a contemporary Christian group, came out with a lot of very powerful, powerful music. And before one of the songs, one of the leaders of that band made this statement, a quote from Brennan Manning. He said, "The greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians." Listen to that again. The greatest single cause of atheism today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, walk out the door, and deny him by their lifestyle. That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. Heavenly Father, I trust that words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, as David said, are pleasing to you. You're the rock, you're the redeemer of my life and of our life. You're the source of our growth. You're the heavenly health that we need in this body. And Lord God, as we have gone through these studies together, and if you tarry your coming one more week and we're able to assemble here next Sunday, we'll put the bow on the package of this series by simply speaking in all the areas that we've talked about, in the links of this wonderful biblical chain of thought. We'll look and we'll study about the going church. But yet, Father, there's business that needs to be done today, right here, right now, in the pews and perhaps even down the aisles of this church. Lord God, I trust that you will take the lives that are sitting in the balcony, and those that here are on this main floor. You'll take leaders as well as many who are good and wonderful followers, guests of ours who have come here, perhaps for the first time or perhaps for many times, but yet they continue to come because they need a word from you. And so, Lord Jesus, here we are, and we've looked at the scripture, tried to be faithful in studying it and understanding it. Now it's time to embrace it. Now it's time to receive it and accept it, and now walk in it and apply it. Because you desire for us to be a people that will glorify you through our growth. And so, Father, help us today to not only be the godly church, and the church that wraps and gathers ourselves around this wonderful gospel message, grounded as we would need to be in our faith and now growing, so that when we do go to the world, there'll be an impact, a holy Spirit anointed impact upon the world. So, Father, whoever may be here today that needs to make that decision for Christ because they've never started that journey. Oh, they're physically here, but Father, they've never started that journey, that spiritual birth. Holy Spirit, I trust that you've spoken to their hearts and their lives in these moments. Perhaps, Father, there's someone here today as a single, a couple, a family, and the warmth of this fellowship has just embraced them to the point that they say, this is the time, now's the place. These are the people that I need to, or that we need to be connected to, that we might continue this growth journey. Maybe there's someone here today, Father, that just needs to get on their face before you, pleading forgiveness because they've put their spiritual growth on the shelf. And now they've determined, and the Spirit of God has spoken to their heart, their life, this is now time for me to be involved. I need to take up my mantle and grow in my relationship with you. Father, whatever you want to do, this has all been for you. The music, the fellowship, our gifts, all of this has been for you. And so, Father, take it. Speak to our hearts, move in our lives right now is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand right now? Brother George comes and stands with us. If you're coming, won't you come from the balcony here on the main floor as we sing together?
Are you broken and hurting?
Come into Christ right now, won't you come?
Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling.
What about you, my friend? Is he calling you?
Have you come to the end
of yourself? Do you need to experience? We're waiting for you right now.
Do you thirst for a drink at the well? Jesus is calling.
Up to the altar.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
As Jonathan just quietly plays, in just a moment we're going to leave this place. Let me ask you this question before we leave, and I'm going to let Brother George announce sweet decision that's been made this morning, but as he quietly plays, and just ask yourself, what am I going to do with what he said? I mean, really, it doesn't matter if I said it. It's really what God said to you. What are you going to do with that? I mean, really, what are you going to do with that? Is it just going to be another Sunday, 22nd of May, the year of our Lord, 2022, and, well, okay, it's about time for lunch. Let's go. Come on. Is that going to be the end of this? Or is there going to be some real serious thought about your life and your health as a follower of Christ? The growing church, are we? And will you be a part of that? That's my prayer. I trust that you'll be a part of that, and that you've already made the decision that you're going to progress and not regress. You're going to devote yourself to the source of that growth. And then you're going to put it on display. Let everybody see. Oh, not because it's about you, but it's about Jesus in you, Jesus from you. May God's people be blessed in this time together of worship. God bless you. Thank you for being here. For our guest, thank you for being here with us. I'm going to leave this now with Brother George. He's going to give us an announcement or two, and then he's going to introduce a sweet family to you, okay? May God richly bless you. Brother George?
Thank you, Dr. Drake. If you two would stand here and turn and I talked to this lovely couple last week. They came up to me and said, lovely.
Yeah.
You like that? They came up to me and they said, you know, we've been here for a while and we would love to be members here of this church and be fully committed. And so they've talked with me. I've talked with the deacons and they talked with Dr. Drake this morning. And so we were walking through that process with them and just super excited for you to join us. So if you could, you show them some love and welcome them. You probably see this guy up there jamming on his bass, so we are so honored that you guys have joined our family, and yeah, we love you guys, so thank you so much. I'm going to share a few more announcements. You're more than welcome to stand here and just look at them or sit down or whatever you want to do. Hey, I would be remiss if we didn't do this, but I did see a graduate come in that wasn't here when we prayed over them, and so if you would and your family come up real quick, I would love to pray over you as well. To make sure we don't miss this opportunity. And I'm sure you'd want the gift that I have for you as well, you know. So this is for you, and love to just pray over you real quick. And is there any other graduates that we missed, maybe came in a little bit later? She was never late for class just this morning, right? It's Bryson time. That's what I've been told. Okay. All right, let's pray over her real quick. Father God, we just thank you this morning. We thank you for Malia. Thank you for all that you've done in her life. The moments that were maybe difficult and maybe the moments that were just so victorious, God, you are still king. And so we thank you for what you've done in and through her. We pray that in this next season that you bring her into, we continue to pray for blessing and favor, just like we prayed earlier this morning for the other graduates, that in this new season is a new adventure. And in that, just like we heard from Dr. Drake and from your word, that she will continue to grow in you, that she is connected to the vine. And because of that, she will bear much fruit. And so we just pray for that blessing over her right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. All right, a few things. Are you going to say something else?
Oh, just invite.
Yeah.
Invite.
Oh, afterwards? Yeah, yeah. One thing I will say that I know I need to grow in is I got to work on that. Man, there's a presence with that. And I think you scare my wife every time you do that. So, seriously, though, great word. I'm challenged. I'm challenged. And a great reminder that I have to always be connected to the vine. A couple things. If you're a first-time guest, in front of you is a Connect card. If you're watching online, I encourage you. We also have an online Connect card. If you'll fill that out this morning and right out in the lobby and you hand it in, we have a gift for you. It's just a way for us to get to know you a little bit better. Tonight, Awana is actually going to be having an award ceremony here at 6 o'clock. And from what I've been told, the adult Bible study talked about last week, you guys are going to be joining them in the sanctuary at 6. So there won't be your traditional study, but you're going to come in and support the Awana group that has worked so hard to earn some of these achievements. And so you guys are going to do that tonight at 6 right here in the sanctuary. For our youth, and if anyone who knows of students in this area, in a couple of weeks, we're going to be hosting a free kind of summer experience. And so June 8th to the 11th, right here in the sanctuary, we're going to be taking some of the students on a couple of adventures throughout the week. Some of it's going to be paintball. Some of it's going to be tubing down the lake and or the river. And so we have some fun stuff planned. The heart behind it is we realize that a lot of these students can't afford sometimes these camps that we travel somewhere and it's, you know, a few hundred dollars. Instead, we said, what if we brought it here to them and we made it available to every student? And the goal is that every night, as we'll have a couple of guest speakers teaching them about why they're here, the whole purpose of summer is to teach them about purpose and their purpose, is that because there's no limitations now on money, that all students are welcome. Come, join us. We don't want to just 30. We want 300. We want 3,000. As many that can fill this room. And we're hoping that every night we'll see an increase because of what God is doing in their life. And so if you know of any student, so any fifth grader that is becoming a sixth grader and any current graduate of high school, they are more than welcome to join us here June 6th to the 11th. And on our website, you can find more information and they can sign up because there are some limited spots on some of the fun things we're doing. But it is free for them. So I just wanted you to know that. Other than that, if you do want to meet Hal and Pam afterwards, please come up, shake their hand, congratulate them, love them. Maybe he'll teach you some of the base moves and it'll just be awesome. So let me just pray a blessing over you. Father, thank you again this morning. I pray for this church body. May we continue to grow in health. May we continue to grow with one another and be connected to the true vine. We praise you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys, and we'll see you throughout the week.